Hey everyone, and welcome to the weekly Nikon Report, your roundup of all the latest Nikon news and anything that we found interesting in the photography industry. I'm Rishi, and this is...
Becky.
That's it.
And we don't have you, because whatever, because you're there.
No, it's fine, it's perfect. That's all we need, really.
Yep.
Hi, and we have a great show for you today.
Yes, Nikon Rumors published a recap of a recent internal... Nikon presentation.
How did they get this?
I was wondering, maybe they've got a little spies on the walls.
Everywhere.
Exactly. They're watching you. And watching us too, apparently. Right.
Nowhere safe.
The demand for the new 105 macro Z lens was apparently higher than Nikon expected, and it will be backordered for a long time, according to this.
Oh, I see. That's the tidbits.
Is that
what it is?
That's the, like... You know, we're going bullet points here.
All right, bullet points. Okay, the next one up is 7 new Z mount lenses are expected to be released. Well, we know about that. We found 7 lenses that will be released, and there are 3 that we don't know of. So, fingers crossed, we will find out.
Yes.
And what was the next one?
The next one was that Nikon are giving Z bodies and long lenses to pros who will be attending the Olympics. They're putting a marketing campaign together about the Z series and professional use in sports. So...
Okay, before we heard rumors, now we know.
Yeah.
According to Nikon Rumors, who has spies everywhere.
First we heard rumors, now we've heard Nikon rumors. So I'm guessing this is their long lenses and Z9s, because they haven't specified.
Mm.
But that would be the most logical step forward, obviously, because that is supposedly a sports and wildlife camera.
That's true. You can't do much with macro lenses, can you?
No. One moment. Carry on, as you will. Okay, so next up we have many lenses and bodies are in short supply due to material shortage and chip supplies. Nikon doesn't see that changing this year.
Okay, so this is the new bit. It's not going to change this year, so be ready for more delays.
Yes, I think that just generally means we have to be a bit more patient. We have not only chip shortages, but that fire that happened. We have Brexit. We've talked about this last week.
I want to scream, Becky.
You can scream all you like, just don't scream at me.
The rage is spiding up inside me.
Because you want your stock. You want your equipment. Yes, we want our stuff. Unfortunately, we just have to be patient. It is completely out of their hands, and we have to be kind. Be more kind. That's my slogan for today.
Keep calm and carry on. And listen to Becky and Con.
That's the slogan for our show. Next up, Nikon flies all equipment to the US. So the cost of airline space is now very competitive.
And expensive.
That doesn't make any sense.
Very competitive and expensive. It's a competitive expensiveness.
That's an oxymoron right there. But anyway, okay, fine.
Well, the spy had some hearing problems.
Yeah.
If only he would have those massive microphones that we use here.
We've got these great Mondo microphones.
We overcompensate for things.
For our small microphones. No plans. No, sorry. Oh my God.
What is... It used to be this.
It's true.
But now...
Look at that.
It's this.
There are no plans for a new DxDSLR camera or lens for now. So I guess no Nikon D3500 replacement.
Yeah. Again, just to say that basically D3500s and D5600s were gone by chip shortage. They're too expensive to produce and there are no chips around. So even if you look on eBay for chip for D3500, it costs like £2,000 and it's just a chip.
That's not true, right? You haven't looked on eBay for chips for D3500.
Who looks on eBay for things like this, Becky?
However, as we mentioned last week, Nikon Japan are doing an offer on these cameras. So we're very confused.
I think they discovered a box full of them in a warehouse.
Maybe. Send some our way, please. We need them. I don't like this rumor just because I don't know that that's true. But anyway, it says Nikon Z9 to be announced in the fourth quarter of 2021. Now, this, I guess, means not the fourth financial quarter.
No, just the 2021.
Yeah.
So that makes sense because, yeah, the fourth quarter of 2021 is what? October, November, December.
Yeah.
Makes sense.
Okay. I was hoping it was going to be a little bit earlier than that. But...
Well, who knows? Maybe we'll see some specs.
Sure.
Eventually. Or we'll see some, you know... like 1000% zoomed in image of someone holding a square camera with the logo taped up so you don't know what it is, and then we say, well, it's a prototype.
Yes, that could happen. Nikon D850 and D5 replacements could still happen next year.
I'm excited.
And you're like, yeah.
Yay, Nikon power. D850 for sure. D500, not so sure. But if Nikon says it's going to happen, power to them.
Over the next year, we will see many, many F-mount products being discontinued. But the Nikon D780 will stay for a while.
It will stay the same. As you remember it.
No change.
Looking at you, sadly, in a corner.
But, okay, I don't like this announcement either. I mean, I don't like it. I liked the 7 new lenses and the, you know, all that kind of stuff. I was good with that. But I don't like this.
It's a tough one because, obviously, we know it's going to happen eventually. It doesn't mean that we like it.
No.
But it seems like it's just a sign of things to come. And unfortunately, it is what it is. Of course, we're disappointed. We want them to make those lenses for years to come. But it seems like that the Z mirrorless system push is happening. So they want us to upgrade. And eventually, technically, you need to start to make more products in different lights. So the products that haven't existed. So you need to create a space. You need to create a pipeline on your factories.
Sure.
To produce it. So something had to give eventually. So, and if you manufacture quite a lot of products, and a lot of those, like 14mm 2.8 DAF lens that's been discontinued very recently.
Yeah.
Well, it is an old lens, very old design. They probably sell like 10 of those a year.
Mm.
It doesn't make sense to keep something like this. Of course, if something like D850 becomes discontinued without the replacement, that's a big issue. But some of the old lenses, I would expect this to happen.
Okay, fair enough. Con has spoken. Apparently, a new Z entry-level model camera is expected in late 2022, people. That's quite a long while away.
I got excited for a second.
I know.
Okay.
And then you just felt the disappointment.
Well, again, chip shortage, I guess.
Yeah.
That's the only logic I can apply to this. But you know.
Exactly. So if parts, supplies, issues are resolved this year, the announcement could come earlier. Fingers and toes crossed. Can you cross your toes?
I can.
Yeah, okay. Yeah. Let's do that.
I'm from Russia.
I don't know what that's got to do with anything.
But also what I want to say is if you walk around the street, do look behind your back because Nikon rumors can be everywhere.
They can. Apparently there are the flies on the wall and everything. So the two new Nikkor Z, 28 f2.8 and 40 f2 pancake, not pancake, lenses could be announced together with the new Z camera.
All right. Well, Nikon rumor is still not 100% sure about this rumor, but if that Z thing happens, because it's small and light and it's retro and it's almost FM3 like, etc., I think it does make sense to release small lenses to go with it. Not could be 28, could be 40, could be one of those, you know, 35mm lenses. You never know. But something small to basically go with the body.
Maybe. I think that the two announcements should be separate, personally.
Give it space to breathe.
I think so. I think that the not pancake lenses, because they're not pancake lenses, but the compact lenses have their own place in the Z lineup. And then this new camera has whatever. I mean, the rumor mill goes wild on it, but it has its own place separately.
Absolutely. Like a good wine, leave it in decanter to breathe a little bit.
That's right.
All right. Well, since we're on that topic, let's jump in news and go to more leaked pictures of upcoming Nikon ZF Retro C camera has popped up on the Nikon Rumors again. Nikon Rumors been on a roll this week.
Yes.
So we got three more images. One of the viewfinder, one of the dial, and another one of the dial as well, supplied by user NPR.
Now, I will say, I really hope they don't call it a ZFC. I think ZF will do.
Well, Z Football Club, it's like...
Z Football Club, yeah.
Yeah, that's Football Club. It's good, you know. So I would support that team. I would probably subscribe for the season ticket. So they send me a camera every year.
Yeah. This is the content you're here
for. That's the logic behind it. Interesting. Let's see what happens. According to Nikon rumors, we will see the announcement on 28th of June, which is next week.
Yeah, so not long to wait on that one if it is indeed true. When I look at those pictures, it does make me think very much like, oh, FM2, FM3A, that's kind of where it's getting its design from.
That's true. I still want this little screen, the Casio watch screen that they have there,
yeah,
with the F letter on it, not just to show F number of the lens, but also be a sign to show the amount of remaining pictures.
It's true. It's very cute if it's real. But, you know, it's also quite a pixelated shot. And if you look at that, it could be not real. or it could be real.
Well, we'll find out in a week, isn't it?
Exactly.
The next one up.
So the Nikon Z MC macro 105 lens demand is too high, according to Nikon, and they apologize for not being able to deliver to everyone who pre-ordered on day one. Nikon Japan have actually issued an apology notice, so this isn't just, we're not just making this up. They've said, thank you for your continued patronage of Nikon products. We have received a large number of reservations for the Nikkor lens Nikkor Z MC 105 f2.8 VRS, which is scheduled to be released on the 25th of June 2021. Friday. We may not be able to deliver the product on the day of release to some customers who are currently making reservations. In addition, it may take some time for the product to be delivered to customers who make reservations in the future, as it will be delivered in sequence. We sincerely apologize for any inconvenience caused to customers who are waiting for our products. We will do our utmost to deliver the product as soon as possible, and we appreciate your understanding.
Okay, so the bad news, but also, in my opinion, there's some good news. Let me tell you why. Obviously, the bad news is for you who pre-ordered and didn't do it, let's say, on day one of announcement, you may not receive your lens on the day one, which is sad, and I understand the frustration. Now, the good news is it's a nice problem to have because it shows that demand on the lens is quite high. People are hungry for new lenses on that system, and they're willing to pay the money. So I think it's a nice problem to have. A lot of people on forums say, oh, it's artificial demand. Well, no, because if you look at the past year, what's been happening, there are shortages of everything. Yeah. And not just Nikon, but also other photographic brands. So not being able to produce enough product on day one to supply demand, yes, it's sad, but it's not the end of the world. And I think that people who will wait, they will get rewarded with a nice lens that will stay with them for years, and I'm sure they will be able to take many shots over the years as well.
Exactly. And for any of our customers who've pre-ordered and may not receive their lens on day one, we also ask for your patience and thank you for ordering with us. Just bear in mind that we are people that have to deal with these orders. So obviously we will do everything we can to get your order to you as soon as possible. But my motto this week is be kind.
We have feelings.
We do. Especially me. Me who bears the brunt of all the upsets.
I read the comments after all our videos and then I cry in the corner for hours.
Yeah.
How was your weekend? Fine.
It was great. I'm fine.
The next one up, we have a special guest today. Ricci himself.
Hey, everybody.
Ricci Talks.
Apparently.
On the internet?
Apparently on the internet as well, yeah.
All right. And he is here to tell us more about those macro lenses that Nikon apparently announced a couple of weeks ago.
These ones.
Can you tell us more about them? Tell us something that the internet doesn't know about.
I don't think there is anything that the internet doesn't know about them right now. The only thing I could think of at the top of my head, probably around the 50, is that not many people have been talking about the 50. I've been putting together some nice content on the 50. Really surprised by the performance of the 50mm. I think it's going to be really useful macro lens for people who either want to start out with macro photography or they're already doing macro photography but they just don't want something that's as serious as like the 105. Now, in all honesty, if you are into macro photography, you know if you need a 105 or a 50. And in most cases, that might be the 105 because of the shooting distances. But for those of people who are starting out in macro or they're using it for product or food or stuff like that, I think the 50 is going to be a really surprising lens for those types of photographers.
Nice.
So you are making the video about 50?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I've just not edited it yet.
So. Okay.
When's the premiere?
Probably before this goes live.
Yeah, it's a good point. This will be out in
two people, one mic. Like,
when does this go out?
Wednesday, if we are lucky.
It might be out before then.
Okay.
It might not. It depends when I get home after this.
So looking at the 50 is the one that excites me, just because I use a 60 as my sort of general.
Sure.
It goes with me everywhere kind of lens. And it is smaller and lighter than the 60. We've actually got a little D version here. Mm-hmm. But one of the bigger questions I had was, would it work with the ES2? And you said...
Yes.
And I couldn't work out how. But we have just realized that it actually has a 62mm thread as well as a 46mm thread. So that's the answer to your question, if you were asking it.
So the 46mm thread is actually the lens hood, the tiny lens hood that you see on this lens.
Yeah, that lens does have its lens hood on, which does catch a lot of people out. But
so this lens hood is designed to basically eliminate the flare, but in the macro distances. Is that correct?
Yeah, so it still does its job as a lens hood. And some people might not think that it's a very substantial lens hood.
No.
It's not. But you also have to consider that if you were to put a larger lens hood on at the working distances of this lens, you're going to have issues with it contacting or hitting subjects that you're trying to shoot. You obviously have to make adjustments for it being a macro lens.
So we did have that announcement where we're expecting some shortages, or let's say there was more demand for the 105 than was originally expected. Mm-hmm. Would your sort of opinion be maybe to point people towards looking at the 50mm? Because as far as I understand it, there's less demand of the 50.
Well, you're the guys that know about what your demand is, right, for your pre-orders and such.
Yeah.
So from my point of view, as I mentioned earlier, I think if you know that you want a 105, then the 105 is still going to be the lens that you want.
Sure.
And could the 50 be like a stopgap? I'm not sure about that. I think for some photographers, the 50 will be their go-to macro lens, like you use your 60.
Mm.
But if you're really serious about your macro and you know that you need the working distance of the 105,
then
yeah,
it's the 105. I mean, yeah. Also, I would say you can do insect work with the 60, or I would assume the 50. Mm-hmm. Even at the, it's a bit of a struggle at those very close focusing distances.
Yeah, you hold a gun in front of it. Yeah,
like, just stay still, little ant. No. Yeah.
So I mean, like when I was shooting with the 105, you saw from the content that I've made about the 105.
Yeah,
it was just real easy to capture insects and stuff like that. That's been a little bit more difficult with the 50 because you just can't physically get close to them without them moving or being spooked and so on.
Mm.
It is possible. I've got some great content with snails.
Oh, yeah.
But
they don't move fast.
No, they don't move. But like you say, it is possible, but not necessarily ideal.
Sure.
So I do think the 50 is probably a better place for non-moving subjects.
Have you tested 50 as a normal lens, let's say, for just general photography?
Yeah, so one of the things that you'll see is a test against the 50 2.8 versus the
50 1.8.
Mm. Can you give us a little heads up?
You might have to wait for that.
Oh, no spoilers here.
No.
Any trailer? You know, they normally kind of give away everything in the trailer, no?
No.
We're going to do is we'll have to somehow make sure that if your video comes out before this one, then we can link it in the description.
Oh, yeah.
Box.
So we'll do I'll say like, oh, it does this.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
It's only going to take me about 3 days to figure out how to do this, but otherwise it's possible, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah.
Sky's the limit. Okay, great. And then this is the first look that we've had of the 105. It's actually noticeably lighter than the F-mount version, which I think definitely works in its favor, even though it looks bigger. And my automatic thought was that it was going to be a really bulky thing. So I think that's going to sort of balance quite nicely, mm-hmm. both on the lighter Z cameras, like the Z50, as well as... Have you used it on the Z50?
I used the 50 on the Z50.
Okay.
I've not used the 105.
The important questions, Becky.
Yeah.
Have you used it on Z50?
That's where my brain automatically goes.
But you're right in terms of size, because if you use it on Z cameras and you had FTZ adapter next to it, which we probably will try now, that actually makes it bigger.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not just bigger, it's also heavier.
Yeah.
Yeah. The setup is quite a bit heavier when you add the FTZ.
Yeah.
But the 50, obviously being a full frame 50, is then cropped if you put it on a Z50. But you get some really nice results from that. And
I quite like that.
The weight isn't too heavy because the 52.8 is nice and small and lightweight.
Yeah, exactly. Even though it's light, it is a metal mount lens, so it's not that they've skimped on it. It just happens to be a very lightweight and quite small lens. But I was going to say, your review of the 105, mm-hmm. it was noticeably sharper.
Yeah, I mean, that was, you know, and obviously just to remind people that I'm dealing with sample lenses here, so they're not final production units. The quality that you see might not represent what you get. And that's the case with all sample stuff. But the key thing is that, and this is, you know, it's kind of to be expected at this point, not really expected in some cases, but we've seen quite clearly that a lot of the newer Z mount lenses, because they're newer designs, they are just sharper. They produce better results, not only when it comes to sharpness, but detail, resolution, chromatic aberrations, color fringing, all those types of things. They're just not there, or there's tons of detail that you have in your images that you just didn't get with the older lenses. So yeah, I must, you know, when I did that comparison and I shot that and I put it into Lightroom and I wanted to try and record my reaction to it, I kind of went, wow.
Very YouTube-y.
Yeah, this is ridiculous. Like, and in all honesty, I did it a couple of times. because I always just want to double check that what I'm showing you is accurate.
Can you talk us through the process of doing your test? Like, what do you normally do? Like, let's say for that motherboard that you photographed or whatever it was, what was the science behind it?
So everything was in place, was locked in place effectively. So even though you couldn't see it in the image, the motherboard was tripod mounted. I used a mixture of a clamp and an L bracket. Mm-hmm. My camera is tripod mounted and it was lit. So it was lit with constant lights. Mm-hmm. Because I always want, if I'm showing a comparison of two lenses, I want everything to be consistent. So mm-hmm. I want the lights to be consistent, the position of the camera and everything to be consistent. And then when I did the test and I then saw the comparisons, I was like, have I done something wrong? Mm-hmm. And I then just go and try and do it again. And if I get the same consistent result, I know that is what it is.
So it's not just one take, it's several takes.
All the time. I don't think there's any comparison I've ever done where I've done it just on the first comparison, which takes up a lot of time, but it means that I'm not putting out anything that isn't accurate, because mm-hmm. I can't do that. I don't want to do that.
That's so true. And you focus manually all the time, just make sure
that shot it was manual focus. Mm-hmm. Most of the time I'm manual focus. Unless I'm doing like autofocusing tests and stuff like that anyway. But especially for the macro stuff, that comparison specifically was manual focused, just so that I can make sure that they're accurately focused. Because that's what I thought. I thought, oh, maybe the FMAP 105 wasn't quite manually focused the same way, because the difference between manual focusing on these lenses is massive.
Mm. Yeah, it's striking.
The ability to fine tune the focus on this by slowly focusing the lens and it only moves a tiny amount is incredible. Whereas with this lens, you have to be a little bit more specific about where you're focusing it. So I just wanted to make sure that I'd not done anything wrong and that everything was as it should be.
So we're talking about basically new generation of lenses, really, not just a new lens for Z mount. It's a new generation of designers.
Yeah. And you know, don't get me wrong, you know, as lenses progress, as things improve, does it mean that all of a sudden your old 105 isn't going to take very good pictures? No, it's still going to shoot the same way that it has for the past however many years. But for those people, those photographers who do want better quality, who are striving to have the best quality they can get from their lenses, that's obviously currently where Z mount lenses are going.
Thank you.
No worries.
So you should come more often.
Sure, if you'd invite me.
Talk to us.
Look, we record every Monday, so you're welcome. You know, 2 p.m.
I'm normally quite busy on Mondays, but
fair enough. Yeah. We won't hold you to
need to reschedule the podcast then, huh?
That's it.
Maybe.
We will have you back in a couple of weeks, I think, for a live stream or something, maybe once we've had a chance to use these little babies, which should be with us soon. If you haven't pre-ordered yet, please do. As we've been saying, it's more likely that the 50 mils will be readily available. So if you've got your eye on that one, then just head over to our website where you can place your order.
Richard, tell us, where can we find you on the internet?
There's quite a few places.
Yeah.
The ones I'd recommend would be YouTube, and my channel is just Ricci, which is R-I-C-C-I.
Can you tell me the place which you can't recommend?
No.
The dark alleys of the dark web.
No, those are the websites that I don't like to talk about.
Okay. Yeah. Fair enough.
No, mainly what I tend to find is I find myself appearing on websites that I didn't even know about, and it was people obviously just talking about the videos that I make.
So, I see.
Yeah, because obviously on YouTube, it tells you where people have viewed your videos from or where they've come from.
Yeah.
So if there's like a random website that I've never seen before, I'm like, oh, you know, what's this website about? And it's all of a sudden just like a camera forum.
Do you think it's like a Sony army just doing the work, you know? Yeah,
No.
I
don't think I get many Sony users.
No.
How many people switched from Sony to Nikon?
I have no idea. I have no idea. Have they switched from your videos?
I'm sure they did. You know who you are.
Yeah. Leave us a comment if you switched from Sony to Nikon because
after
of our
watching
channel.
This.
Mm-hmm. I think the key thing for me and the reason that I make my videos is I just want people to be better at photography.
Actually, as a YouTuber to YouTube, as the influencers, as ourselves, yes, I want to know what goes into that.
Yeah. You know? For me, like the first reason I wanted to do it was that I wanted to be to make people better at photography, to help them get better at their photography. It's obviously kind of turned into a little bit more kit focused, which is fine by me. I'm just as interested in kit as anybody else. And hopefully they help people figure out what the right kit for them is.
Mm.
Like eventually I'll do a video between the two macro lenses showing examples of both and you would then be able to say, right, this is what I want or this is what I want, rather than having to buy both. Or, you know, the prime lenses or the zoom lenses. I did a video, I think it was almost last year now, about the Z zooms versus the Z mount primes and like which one's going to be best for you, which one you should buy, that type of stuff. So hopefully I'm just trying to help people buy the right kit that's right for them. And then in between that, I also do videos that are just about setting up cameras, and there'll be a lot more kind of photography based stuff in the future as well.
And how can we get free stuff?
I don't really have too much free stuff to give away. It might be something in the future, you don't know.
But actually, you know, like I was leading with that, but your answer and actually your videos, in our opinion, they do represent this objective information where you just deliver the facts. Yeah. You don't go with the hype. You don't oversell. You just go say, well, this is how it behaves. This is what tests I did. Mm-hmm. That's how it works. So that's why we really like your channel and we recommend it on our podcast.
Yeah. Well, I mean, thanks for that. but that, you know, I don't want to be that person that's like, oh, this is amazing, unnecessarily.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I do obviously have my own opinions on things. And if I like something, I will tell people that I like something. Especially those people who know me personally, not through YouTube, they'll know that if I do like something, I'll shout about it.
Mm-hmm.
But I never really wanted to try and convey that. I want people to make their own decisions. So I always say that, you know, I'll talk about my opinions, but form your own. I'm just trying to be another way of you accessing what this lens or camera can do. By all means, if you can still go and access it in a shop, then go and do that. If you can look at it somewhere else, go and do that as well. If you can come to Gray's and, you know, look at it there, then do that as well, right? So that it's just one aspect of that entire research, or that one aspect of your entire research into a product that you're looking at buying from Nikon.
Basically. That's true. Do you have your YouTube voice?
Apparently I have a YouTube voice, but I've been talking in my same voice for the entirety of this podcast. So
I think it's a pretty good YouTube voice. Yeah. Yep.
Hey, everybody.
My voice.
Yeah, I've got my voice. What's my voice? Not a YouTube voice.
Well, Becky had a job at BBC, but she chose Grace.
I turned it down.
Yeah. Did you actually?
No. No, I did not. No voiceover work for me. No.
Fantastic. Thanks so much, Richard.
No worries. Thanks for having me. And I'm sure we'll do some stuff together again.
Yeah, absolutely.
Been good fun.
All right, some positive news. Tom Hogan, our mate Tom, thank you so much for being you, published an article which is called Two New Lens Patents. So he writes about two lens patents that have been registered in Japan this week. The first one, which is exciting to me and probably to you. For me, it's exciting because it's a lens that we didn't think that ever will be replaced.
Nope.
For you, you like macro photography.
Yeah.
So the first one is for 90 to 140 millimeter f4 to 5.6 VR micro lens.
Mm.
So that one, it looks to me, well, Tom says it's probably something like 70 to 150 design, but to me, it more sounds like 70 to 180 micro lens.
Yeah.
You know, so that's been discontinued about 3-4 years ago. The price
try like 10, 12 years ago.
10, 20 years ago, 50 years ago. And the prices on the secondhand ones are actually now are higher than they were available brand new.
That's very true.
So that's how important this lens is to many people. So 90 to 140 micro Nikkor, we don't really have any micro Nikkor zooms around.
No.
It's a very interesting development. So what he says that it will have 1-to-1 reproduction ratio and then vibration reduction. And that is very nice to have.
That is very nice to have. And if it is 1-to-1 and VR, those are two sort of top perks that are over and above the 70 to 180, because the 70 to 180 was, first of all, not 1-to-1 reproduction and also obviously wasn't VR. It was the old AF construction, which meant that it took an age to focus.
Exactly, especially if you would use autofocus.
Yeah, I've used that lens both auto and manual, but it has that sort of almost like film-like look about the rendering. It's very classic.
Absolutely. I think it's one of the lenses of the old lenses that we actually have a waiting list for.
Yeah, exactly, in secondhand. Now, they also have a patent out for the 200 f4 with a built-in teleconverter option using a new type of TC relay design. This produces a 200 f4 with 280 f4 and 400 mil f5.6 options.
Okay, I wonder if it's going to be something like 4.5 or 4.8 at 280.
Yeah, because he says f4, but that doesn't, I don't totally understand that. He says, I'm still trying to decipher all the technical information on this lens and I don't know if it's practical to build yet, but it does show the Nikkor designers are heading in some interesting new directions.
Absolutely. And then obviously this is a patent announcement. It could take years for those lenses to materialize.
Might never happen.
Exactly. So, but it's good news. Who knows? That means that, yeah, Nikon is considering to replace all the lenses. Who knows? Maybe you'll see a 200 micro as well at some point.
Love it.
All right. Well, the next bit of news I'm personally quite happy about. The inevitable happens.
Yeah.
The Z5 body in United States reached this magical mark of under £1,000. It is currently priced at $999 pretty much everywhere in dealers close to you.
Yes.
Why is it important? I'll tell you why, baby.
Just tell me. It's fine. Just do it.
Full frame body under £1,000 was a holy grail for a lot of manufacturers.
Yes.
Now, having a Z system camera, so we had D600 and D610 at the time, and then 750 was very close to that. I think it got in UK close to £1,070 or so. Mm-hmm. So to get Z body to that magical mark is quite important because A, it means more sales, B, it's finally put Z5 in a great price point compared to Z6. Now you have actually, fractal differences between the two, not just technical differences.
Yeah.
And it's an attractive package for a lot of people. It's a lot more affordable than it used to be.
Absolutely. Next up, Nikon have released a new firmware version 1.30. They've added a new option, which is called Keep Exposure When F Number Changes. It's been added to the custom settings menu at position B8. When off is selected for ISO sensitivity, basically when auto ISO is off, the photo shooting menu mode in M, actions such as switching to a lens with a different aperture range may cause unintended changes to aperture. If an option other than off is selected for keep exposure when F number changes, the camera will adjust the shutter speed or ISO sensitivity to maintain exposure at its current value. Other actions to which automatic exposure maintenance applies includes adjusting zoom on lenses that have different values for maximum aperture and minimum zoom, and attaching a teleconverter and changing the focus distance when a micro lens is attached. So,
all right, let me read what the thing that I understood.
Yeah.
Changes have been made to improve the reliability of the autofocus operation.
Excellent. Yay. Okay, so keep exposure when F number changes. It basically means if you're changing your lens, if you're zooming or in or out, if you're using a macro lens and shooting at different distances, then essentially the camera will compensate for that by not changing the exposure. So you won't get the picture underexposed from what your settings were.
Thanks for explaining it to me, because I got tired by the time you finished reading all this.
So
because,
did I.
Yeah, it's not you, it's the wall of text that they published. No, now it actually makes sense.
Yes, okay, thank you.
Fantastic. Well, Nikon keeps updating the D6s, right?
Mm-hmm.
So we've just talked about it, what, about a month ago?
Yep, adding value.
Absolutely, keep pumping it up. Updates from Japan. Nikon updated their response to new coronavirus article. So now, Tokyo government, Japanese government, not Tokyo government. Tokyo doesn't have its own government, but Japanese government has lifted the state of emergency in Tokyo on 20th of June. So Nikon says that we're going to go back to normal. We're going to bring people in. We're going to start working hard, get that shortage done and dusted.
Excellent.
More news from Japan. Nikon Museum Japan launched a Nikon Kogaku Hot Shoe cover, which is about 400 pieces were made and it's priced at £25 or $35 plus taxes.
Nice.
A short news week this week, so let's get straight to reviews. For additional coverage of macro lenses that have been announced and coming out next week, we have a couple of videos for you to look at. So first of all is Why Food Photographers Love This Lens by The Bite Shot, and it's about 105 Z macro.
Nice. Then we've also got the Nikon Z MC 50mm f2.8 first look video by Matt Irwin.
Brilliant. Don't forget to look at Rich's video, which is hopefully will be out by the time we release our podcast as well.
And if it is, then we'll put it in the description box so that you can check that out.
And then the last one's called Nikon Z6 Mark II Review 6 months later, the best full frame camera you're probably unbuying by Dan Watson.
It's the best.
The best.
Full frame camera you're probably unbuying. Do check out those reviews, all very useful and relevant to current stuff.
Absolutely, especially if you're a Nikon user. It's quite nice to read about equipment that you have or want to buy.
Mm-hmm. For your weekend read and watch segment, we have ball, three-way, geared, and gimbal. Why choosing the right tripod head matters by DP Review TV YouTube channel.
For some of you who don't know, DP Review is not just a website with articles on it. It's also a YouTube channel.
Wow.
So have a look. Obviously, it's a $1 million question. No, it's not. Which tripod head to buy? Normally, people just buy them together and forget about it. Mm. But if you're a little bit more advanced, then you're going to spend weekends and month choosing which right head to buy.
Right.
This video will help you. Now, Becky, the $1 million question, the real $1 million question.
Yeah.
Do you know which lens? It's a bit of trivia in here. So, which DX lens was the first that Nikon made?
Golly gosh. Was it the 18-270? Is that my wrong?
Yeah, I need a button here. You know, that's a wrong answer. Okay, so the first ever DX lens that Nikon ever produced is 12-24 f4 DX.
You know,
lens.
I was going to say 12-24.
Oh, well, now you say you know, it's like always.
No,
you know?
I was thinking because I was like, the 12-24, but then I thought, because I've read the promo literature on the 12-24 before.
You did?
For some reason recently I was looking for it. I think when we were listing all our 12-24s, I was looking at it and it was like, you know, Nikon's latest addition to the whatever, the lens lineup. But I didn't twig that it was the first DX lens. Maybe they refreshed the marketing material afterwards.
Well, before you were not 100% sure, but now you know.
Now I know for sure.
Absolutely. And since I've declared on this podcast that DX is dead, because we are there on the internet. And since the new Z camera will be announced soon, let's go back to the age of digital SLR cameras.
Did we get to, like, you know, when you do
exactly.
a flashback?
It's all faded and it now becomes black and white. And let's talk about 12-24, the first lens exclusively for digital SLR. Mm. So that is published via the blog, which is called Nikkor, the 1001 Nights, number 68. It's an interesting one. I do recommend to read you all of it, but we're going to just get some of those for you. So some of the interesting ones. So it's not just covers the development of 12-24 lens, but also the development of first digital cameras, including D1.
Wow.
So not just Nikon ones, but Kodaks and the other things.
Right.
You know, Olympus is mentioned there. But also talks about D1 development, D2. 12-24 actually was announced when D2H came out, not before that.
Oh, I see. Golly.
So if you want to find out how it all came to be, do definitely check this blog out.
Next up, we have Large Sense LS911. I guess it's called, Hands On, the first digital large format camera by Richard Brown and Nick Spiker at Petapixel.
All right, what is Large Sense LS911? Rolls off the tongue. It is the first digital large format camera. So it's got 9x11-inch monochrome CMOS sensor.
Wowza.
So it's not a 4x5, it's 9x11, so it's like 8x10 thing.
Yes.
Okay. So this camera is obviously huge. It cost $106,000.
Oh, wow.
So you can buy a Z50.
Yeah.
Or, well, you can buy 106 Z50s, I would say.
You can buy a lot of Z50s.
Or one of those large cameras. So it's a huge camera as well. It's a big box. You need to bring it with you on the truck. You probably will need to use it as a large format camera as well. So you're going to have a little curtain, a little blankie that you're going to put over you. Quite difficult to use, but the images it creates are very interesting. So do check it out. It's obviously one, it's the first one, so you can see it in the infancy. It's not a big company that's creating this. It's one gentleman in California, United States.
Right.
And the new camera that he's going to release, the update, the version 2, is going to be $86,000. And apparently it's going to be a little bit smaller. Still not pocketable.
No.
But it's interesting, isn't it?
It is interesting. I look at the picture here and I kind of try and suss out. It's very hard to scale how big that is. It's like, how big are those blades of grass in the picture of that camera? Is that the size?
Artificially increased.
Is it the size of a person? Like, is that human
height? Yes, have
height?
A look. Have a look at this shot over
there.
Oh,
my goodness. Wow.
It is not small.
No, okay.
I can tell you
because
that.
Because it's very difficult. In that perspective, it looks like a toy camera. In this perspective, now I can see why you'd need a truck.
But have a look at the image it creates. So this is number one. This is the actual image. So it's black and white sensor. So this has been added later on. So shooting with large format film nowadays is quite expensive in the United Kingdom. 8x10 probably will cost you about £15 a shot. So yeah. You definitely don't want to miss it, or you don't want to blink if you're taking a portrait. But it's still cheaper than spending $106,000 for a large format camera.
Yes.
This is it for today.
First of all, we have to thank once again Ricci from Nikon for joining us this afternoon. It was fantastic to have him on the show. Also, thank you very much for watching and or listening. If you would like to give us a like or a subscribe, and a subscribe, I should say, on YouTube, that would be very much appreciated. Or if you're listening on a podcast platform, a follow and perhaps even a review would be most welcome.
Absolutely. It opens up to a lot more people, because the way the discovery algorithm works, the more you give, the more Google gives.
That's right. It's all about the algorithm.
Absolutely. And if you'd like to give Becky a follow, you can find her.
You can find me at Rebecca_Denese on Instagram. I could not remember my handle for a minute there. It's just my name.
It's like your mobile phone, isn't it?
It's my name. And yours?
The same on Instagram, at Rebecca_Denese. Konstantin Kochkin. As long as you can spell this or copy it from the description below in the video, you can find me there and give me a follow.
Yeah, it's a test.
It's a test.
All of the links for things that we've discussed today are in the description box or the podcast notes. So do check those out if you'd like to have a bit more of a read of them. And we will see you next week for another podcast.
I hope we're not blurred today.
Yeah.
Bye.
Thank you. Bye.